All right.
Are we live on video?
We should be live on Facebook now.
So we'll talk about our New Year's, and then we'll jump right into the interview and talk about the Ravens.
Yeah. So we can, that works.
All right.
And I'll keep an eye on it. When you see over here, if you see a phone number pop up down here, that means Tony's on the line. So just cue me over.
Tony.
Hey, Tony.
All right. You ready to go?
Yep.
Have you heard? The bird is the word. Section 336, the next generation of Baltimore sports talk.
Today on the show, the whole crew is back. That's right, boys and girls. We got the bun lover, we got the zany one, and we even got the world's worst intern. We will discuss all the things the Orioles are not doing, which is no surprise. And we'll also discuss all the things the Baltimore Ravens are not doing, which is kind of a surprise. And because we can't figure this whole thing out, we're going to have Tony Lombardi on the show, creator of Russell Street Report, on our One Call Away segment to help us figure all this stuff out. All that and more on this edition of Section 336. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Baltimore sports fans of all ages, welcome to Section 336, the next generation of Baltimore sports talk. I'm your endearing, stuttering host, Matt Soroka, and as always, I'm joined with a zany Bert Rohde.
What up, 336ers?
And the button lover, Josh Soroka.
Pretty sure your voice came out louder than the mask. You got to work on that a little. Well, yeah, if you press the button.
And we're also joined by the world's worst intern.
Hey, happy 2017.
Happy 2017. Welcome to a brand new year. Boys, how was that? Well, Bert, welcome back, man. So apparently...
Did you miss me?
Right. Who had more fun at Disney, Bert or his kids?
I want to go back to Disney World.
So you got a lightsaber. You got a cool mask. Did your kid get anything or did you get all the presents?
Yeah, these are actually my children's. Sorry, I almost took your head off there.
I'm not that concerned.
Disney World was awesome.
Right. It's just a piece of plastic.
How was that? Okay. You also had story time with Cal Ripken.
Oh, yeah. I might want to save that for three up, three down, if you know what I mean.
Oh, no.
Oh, the old Iron Man was a bit of a letdown.
Oh, no. I thought you were going to go with it. I might have to save that for a story time.
Yeah, I was getting excited.
Oh, shoot. Yeah, I should have done a story time. I don't know if it's enough to constitute a whole story, but just to preface it, we were at Walt Disney World. We went on last Wednesday, and every year Christmas time, they do this thing called the Candlelight Processional, which is a really fantastic show. They have a live orchestra, a live choir. It's really impressive. And then they always bring out a celebrity to read the Christmas story, the biblical Christmas story.
Oh, nice.
While the choir and the orchestra performs, and it's really nice.
Yeah, sounds cool.
I went a couple years ago, and it was Blair Underwood, the actor. Very well spoken, did a fantastic job. The guy's a pro. This time last week, they had Cal Ripken Jr. come out and do it.
Nice.
And it was cool to see Cal Ripken there at Epcot.
A lot of people?
It was a lot of people. My home away from home in Epcot. And there is the Iron Man Hall of Famer, Cal Ripken Jr., 2131.
Greatest shortstop ever.
Greatest shortstop ever. And... you can tell he's a pro baseball player, but not a pro reader or actor.
See,
or
he should be better at that. He wrote all those like little kid books. And he goes around reading the kid books.
He wrote all those books. Yes. he was very hot under the lights. He was constantly, using a towel and wiping his entire bald head.
That's a bald problem.
Drinking lots of water.
Oh, I mean, he's played in summer games in the heat, 100 degree weather for.
Because he made the
for
mistake.
For 20 years without ever taking a day off. Now all of a sudden he's getting sweaty reading a story.
He wasn't wearing a baseball cap.
Yeah. He was wearing a nice suit. He was very much reading the script as opposed to, like, performing the script. Yeah.
What did you expect? You think he was going to act out?
I expect Blair Underwood.
A little emotion in the words.
Like Neil Patrick Harris.
a little girly voice when the angel speaks.
Yeah, yeah.
You wanted some voices?
No, just to be more of, like, telling a story as opposed to, and the angels came upon the shepherds and they were so afraid.
So you're saying he was there because he was Cal Ripken.
Yeah, and he was there doing it for 3 days. And that was his first day, third performance of the day. And before they even start the thing, he walks out and goes, "Whew, I am so tired." Like, that's not a good sign there, Iron Man.
We're not. See, that's never happened in baseball. There was double headers. There was never a triple header.
Yeah.
But that was his third of the day?
Yeah.
How bad do you think this first one of the day went?
I don't know. And it's,
well, maybe he was fresher. By the third one, he's worn out.
It's only a 30-minute show, and he's only out there for 20 of the 30 minutes. no, I was crapping him a little bit just because of the reading part. Yeah. But in all seriousness, it was very cool. I was wearing my Cal Ripken jersey, and everywhere we went around Epcot that day, people were like, "Hey, are you here to see Cal Ripken?" I'm like, "No, just wore my Cal Ripken shirt on the day Cal Ripken's reading the Candlelight Processional at Epcot."
Right. What are you talking about?
Who?
Did you have a chance to shake his hand or something?
No,
or
I mean,
high five?
There was no chance. It was packed. You know, I tried to keep an eye out around the stage because he had to get there somehow. Like security.
No, but you're in Disney where they have, like, magic tunnels everywhere. No one sees anyone coming.
That's only at the Magic Kingdom. That's not at Epcot. Only the Magic Kingdom has the secret tunnels. So in order to get to the stage where he was performing, he would have had to walk through the crowds to get there.
That's what you think. Epcot's also like the home of the future land, right?
Yes.
See,
yes.
They've got some future stuff in there, some drones and everything. Cal does not have to drive.
They have a drone show at Disney Springs, but that's a whole other thing.
Right, like a fireworks drone thing, right?
It's really spectacular.
Yeah.
But everything at Disney is spectacular.
See what that could do with
me.
Cal Ripken.
Wink.
Yeah. Well, this is not a Disney World podcast. But
no, unfortunately.
So, Josh, how was your New Year's? What did you do?
You really want to know how my New Year's went?
Sure. Yeah, I don't know. I'm just being friendly.
Yeah, around. It was all right. It was a nice night at home. Really did nothing until about 11:40 when I started vomiting nonstop for the next 6 hours.
Oh, that's right. I meant to wear a face mask to Josh's house tonight.
My wife advised me not to come over at all, actually.
My house has been fumigated.
Okay.
I was the last family member to get it. Everyone else got it last week.
Yikes.
And I got it about 20 minutes before the stroke of midnight. Mm. And then I was up the entire night.
Was that a Burger King salad-ish incident again?
No.
That's old school 336ers.
No, I don't know if it worked in my favor or not, but because remember last week I had a tooth issue.
Yeah.
So on Wednesday I had a tooth pulled because of that. So I wasn't eating much leading up to that. Mm. So it's been quite the.
It's a lot of bile involved, I would guess.
Yeah, it's been quite the two weeks.
I didn't even make it to midnight. I think I was asleep by 10:30.
That was my plan. Then I woke up.
Oh, your body woke you up?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's awful.
I was up to 4 a.m. Intern.
Partying the night away.
Yeah, I'll get to that in a second. Intern, how about your New Year's?
Yeah, I was pretty much sick with pneumonia, so.
Oh, really? Man. Oh, man, that's a real bummer.
Two sickies in the bunch.
Yeah. Well, I had a good time. I stayed home as well, how I like it. My wife had to work, and she works nights, so she was out, you know, at midnight at her job.
So what, video games till 4 a.m.?
No, it wasn't video games this time. That's what my normally go-to is video games. This was, I got hooked watching Boy Meets World marathon.
Oh.
And I watched it till 4 a.m. loving every second of it.
Wow.
Really?
Yeah.
Like, that didn't put you to sleep?
Season 5.
That would have put me to sleep.
Season 5, which is the greatest season of any show of ever.
Like, if I watch
Season 5 of Boy Meets World.
If I watch 5 hours of Seinfeld, I'm falling asleep in the middle because I have them all memorized.
I'd fall asleep in the first 20 minutes.
Right, exactly. I can't watch 5 hours of a show I've already watched.
I just got really hooked. It just made me. It's been a while since I watched it. It made me laugh really hard.
That's good.
I also enjoyed some shout out to Lyons Distillery, some St. Michael's whiskey, which is delicious as well.
And helped out with the Boy Meets World.
Helped out with the Boy Meets World, and I sent a lot of really on point and funny text messages to my wife at work that she never responded to. But whatever, who cares?
She was too busy dealing with the people who blow up their hands shooting off fireworks on New Year's Eve. Does that happen? My mom was a nurse too, and she always complained about New Year's Eve, 4th of July. Yeah. That's when all the idiots come out and blow all their fingers off their hands.
Yeah, she doesn't. She doesn't work in the ER, so she doesn't get all that those issues.
Oh.
But what she does, she doesn't like holidays at all because all the family's there, and like the families always ask the nurse for things. And then he's like, I'm here to take care of this patient. I'm not here to get you a cheeseburger. What are you talking about? So that's her big issues with the holidays. But.
By the way, it's weirding me out that you're not wearing your glasses.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Can you put them back on, please?
There we go.
Thank you.
We're back.
So it's like I don't know where to look at you.
Where to look at me. Hey, my eyes up here, buddy.
So that's an exciting New Year's Eve for all of us.
Yeah, we're getting old.
Yeah, exactly. That's fun.
Hey, there's nothing I'd rather do than stay at home by myself, watch Boy Meets World, and drink whiskey. That's
me too.
Top of my game.
I was hoping the intern would regale us with like wild nights out as 22-year-olds do on New Year's Eve.
Yeah,
but not so much. He got sick too, huh?
I had a very productive New Year's Eve. I got like part of the attic floored. I got a lot of stuff done that day. I thought I was having a great weekend.
Yeah. I went to Epcot and we left at like 5:30 because it was insanity. It was the biggest crowds I've ever seen at Epcot, and I'm glad I left because I got on Twitter afterwards. And
New Year's Eve, of course.
Yeah, like it was nuts. And apparently the World Showcase turns into a massive rave, nothing but neon laser lights.
Well, because don't they celebrate
DJs
as,
in every country?
As the real country?
Unfortunately, no, they don't. I was hoping that would be the case, but they don't.
Oh, you would think they'd. Why don't they do that?
I don't know.
That'd be like an all-day event.
Yeah, it seems so obvious. Like it would be occurring like in Morocco at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Right, and then you build up
to the most important one.
Right, the U.S.
U.S. East Coast.
Down.
By the way, what do people in the Central Time Zone, they're watching Times Square, New Year's Eve, the ball drop, but it's only 11 p.m. for them
when
the ball
drops? They watch their local like Chicago coverage.
That's so lame. Who cares about Chicago New Year's Eve when you got New York City?
I don't know.
I am upset about this.
Do you like New York
City? It is an atrocity.
All the New Year's Eve coverage sucks.
I'm sorry, I missed Mariah Carey, right? She was a highlight, apparently.
I mean, they give shots of everyone in New York, all the mobs, and 75% of them are on their phones. I'm like, I can do that right here on my couch, and I'm warmer and more cozy.
Well, and apparently Times Square, too, there's like no porta potties. You can't go any of the restaurants or stores to use the bathroom.
You got
to
wear a diaper.
People wear diapers or catheters, if you will.
Really?
Yeah, or they just urinate in the street.
I never really thought about that, but you got to go somewhere.
It would have been messed up if I went in there for New Year's Eve. quarter off. Everyone's excited for the ball to drop. It would have been nasty.
Oh, gross.
That is nasty. That is nasty.
So.
All right, we're gonna get into some Ravens talk. I think the Ravens came out with some news. John Harbaugh at a press conference. I think we're going to be kind of at opposite ends of opinions here.
Right. Oh, boy.
So I'm curious to see where this conversation
Did you watch
goes.
The game on Sunday?
You know, I was watching the Maryland game first, and Maryland blew like a 10-point lead. The total meltdown. Terrible loss to Nebraska.
Wow.
And then after that, it was like, I don't know, end of the second quarter, and then I switched over and watched some of the Ravens game. But not really caring. And then I went to Twitter. People were all fired up about it.
There was, people, Twitter.
I mean, this game doesn't matter. Whatever.
Twitter, people were angry on Twitter. Like, I can't imagine if that game actually meant something. I don't think the anger was there. I think the anger was because of John Harbaugh saying, it's a matter of pride. We're going to play hard. We're going to try to win this game. And then you watch the game, and no one's trying.
No.
Well, why would you? People talk about, like, they're giving up on the coach. I don't think that's a reflection of John Harbaugh.
It's
a reflection of you just played the biggest game of the season, and you lost, and you understand that this game means nothing.
Right, right.
You expect them to play their hearts out.
Right, but John Harbaugh shouldn't have said all that crap leading up to the game.
I don't know what you're going to say. We're going to say we're not going to try hard?
You say we're going to prepare for next year.
I don't think as a head coach, you can't say that.
We're going to put Keenan Reynolds in there, see if he can catch the ball. We're going to see if throw some jump balls to Perriman, see what he can do.
But that's not how he coached.
No,
he didn't put Keenan Reynolds in. He started Joe Flacco. Joe Flacco played the entire game.
I know. I don't know if that – I don't like that move.
I don't really care.
You say you're preparing for next year, but that's really code for next year's draft. Give for the lower draft pick.
Right.
I would have been really irritated if they won.
Right.
Well, same thing with last year when they beat the Steelers for no reason. It didn't help at all. It's we beat the Steelers.
It almost prevented the Steelers from getting in the playoffs. That was the only.
Yeah, but it didn't.
Yeah,
it didn't. We cost us a lower draft pick, and we got stuck with Ronnie Stanley,
who's turned out to be a decent player.
Oh yeah, yeah. I was just trying to think of who would have been who we could have gotten at a lower pick. We probably still would have taken him anyway.
Ezekiel Elliott.
Yeah, right.
That would have been fun.
Yeah, I had the choice between a 15-hour drive or watching the Ravens game, and I chose a 15-hour drive.
Oh, wow. That's an intense hatred.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's just...
That 15-hour drive would have still had to happen, though, right?
For the way I've treated this entire season, pretty much, it would come as a shock if this is the one game I chose to watch. It would make no sense at all. So
right.
I opted for what was necessary to drive home.
It would kind of make sense that you didn't watch anything until it was pointless. That kind of fits with how your season is gone.
That is like the zaniest thing I could have done.
I did just little DraftKings to make it interesting and put a few bucks on a couple players just out of reason to watch any games.
Did you win anything?
No, I lost it all. Yeah. I always do.
I watched like a quarter and a half of the game.
Yeah,
not much. It was an ugly game. Ravens looked real bad. Tucker's best guy on the team. Well, I don't know. What's his name? Lineman guy. And then I'm blanking on now.
Not Orr.
No, offensive line. He's been playing injured.
Yanda, you're talking about?
Yanda. He was a guy that probably deserves MVP. I know they gave it to Tucker.
Yeah.
Because Tucker's the face, the points.
But the problem with him is his greatness is counteracted by Zuda's suckiness. And they just cancel each other out.
Oh, yeah. Zuda is so bad. Zuda's got to be gone.
Yeah. Can we start there with moves to be made next year?
Zuda.
I mean, we're going to have Tony on in a minute.
Yeah.
Obviously, the talk is that today Harbaugh coming out and saying, my coaching staff is staying intact.
Yeah. Which was very surprising.
Very surprising. Yeah. That. DNPs, we could all understand. I mean, I think the team still ended up with a 10 or 11
number nine
defense.
Number nine. We were top 10 in almost every category as far as defense goes.
So that's a decent defense.
Except for when you're playing against a good team.
When you're playing against a good team in the fourth quarter, we tend to fold.
Well, and that speaks more to your players than your
coach. Steelers and Patriots really stand out.
So, but yeah, I think everyone was surprised about Marty. I'm only one. Superman got nothing on me.
I'm only one call away. Section 336 is now happy to be joined by the creator of Russell Street Report and Utah Street Report, your best sites for all your Ravens and Orioles news, Tony Lombardi. Thanks for joining us.
Hey guys, how are you tonight?
Good, good.
I'm all right.
Tony. A lot of Ravens news here. I feel like, Tony, like that you are one of the better guys as far as running the website and on Twitter. Like, you understand what Baltimore fans are thinking. And from us right here, we're like kind of scratching our heads on why our offensive coordinator and defensive coordinator are all coming back with John Harbaugh next year. Is this just us, or is all of Baltimore kind of scratching our head, especially with the offensive coordinator, Marty, coming back next year? Like, why?
Well, I think that it's not just the fans. I think there's a lot of people in the media that are, you know, between surprised and shocked that not one of them is going. You know, I talked to a few guys today, and most of them thought that Marty would be gone and that Dean Pease would hold on to his job. I was of the opinion that they should both lose their job.
Yeah.
And I'm not a big proponent of, you know, upsetting families and changing things just for the sake of change. I just thought that there was enough body of work on both sides to justify a change. Now, I guess I'll speak about Marty first because he was the more expected of the two to be fired, but wasn't. I just think that, you know, you've seen enough of this offense. You've seen and heard John Harbaugh say week in and week out, whether it was Trestman or Morningwig, that they need to commit to the run more. And then week in and week out, there were excuses as to why they didn't run the football, even though running the football at times was working in the game that they abandoned it.
Yeah.
So I didn't get that. And for that reason, and we've seen Joe Flacco at his best. Maybe that was a subliminal slip, Joe Harbaugh. But Joe Flacco at his best when he's got a ground game to depend on and can utilize play action.
Of course, yeah.
Yep. But, you know, and most quarterbacks would like to have their best friend would be a running attack. But they just kept abandoning it. And and just a couple of I think the things that really worked best for Joe Flacco, and I know Cam Cameron really got a lot of criticism for being too conservative with Joe, but managing the game, taking strikes downfield when you can, and, you know, just controlling the football and minimizing mistakes is a formula that is tried and true and works in the NFL. Now, I'm not saying you not pay a guy franchise money and ask him to just be a game manager. I don't think you do that. But you can take it to the next level, but still keep those basic principles involved in the offense. So Marty, to me, was a guy, and I look at this Game Pass coaches film most of the time, and I see plays week in and week out that are left on the field.
Right.
And then I see plays like against the Patriots where they were not flooding zones at all. They were just going into the zones and running the routes, which really just, you know, is falls right into the teeth of the zone defense. It's exactly what you don't want to do. You want to flood zone. So I just had some issues with the play calling with that. I had issues with the mix of run versus pass. And, you know, I just think the offense just lacked creativity to get into to be competitive with a lot of the better teams and their offensive schemes. You know, you look at like the Steelers and they're running a lot of different plays. They'll mix in a gadget play here and there. It's almost like the Ravens, if they run a gadget play, they're insulted by even the mention of it.
Yeah.
And, you know, they don't do any of those kinds of things. So that's all.
And on top of all that, not to mention the clock management, which I think all Ravens fans have seen Joe Flacco and along with the offensive coordinator not know how to run a 2-minute offense at all.
Yeah, but I put that on Joe.
Because
when you're a 9-year veteran and you've done it before time and time again, I see him out there doing it at practice all the time. The way that team has lacked energy and a sense of urgency too many times in the no huddle is just, you know, that's got to fall on the quarterback because he's the one that's got to get them rallied up to the line of scrimmage and everything. I've seen them in more have more of a sense of urgency when they shouldn't have a sense of urgency. When they're trying to kill the clock, I see them, you know, get the plays off faster than when they should. You know, it's kind of weird.
There's still, like, plenty of strikes against Marty enough that he could be justifiably fired. So, like, what is the logic here with John Harbaugh and the organization wanting to keep – Marty on? What's the argument for him?
I've talked to Steve Bisciotti enough to think I know him a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And he really thinks things through in a way that is uncommon. And that's probably why he's a self-made billionaire.
Right.
So I just think he's a really smart guy and has a way of seeing things before they become clear to other people. And the only thing I could think of is this, that he may have concluded that, okay, if we improve, if we tweak this and that, maybe we're 10-6 instead of 8-8. We're in the playoffs and we got a shot. I think he'd be happy with that with this team. I also think that he understands this team needs additional personnel that coaching can't make up. You either have it or you don't. And I think that he probably recognizes this. And here's the other thing. If he lets these guys fix it, great. Everybody's happy.
Right.
But if they fail together, and you're not throwing another coordinator at Joe Flacco again in 2018 and 17 and 16 and 15, you know what I'm saying? So it's like let's see what they do together. This is really he's basically allowed those three coordinators and John to paint themselves into a corner.
Right. John Harbaugh's making his bed, and
he just put an expiration date on his tenure in Baltimore that could be renewed based on his performance next year. But if we're talking about an 8-8 team again this time next year, then they're all gone.
Yeah.
Some people will say, well, why would you uproot the team so much and have such big upturn or upheaval? And I said, well, the last time they did that, they went to the playoffs 5 straight years. They went to 3 FC championship games and they won 1 Super Bowl.
Yeah, not too bad. But my concern is, and this is what we see, I think, going on with the Orioles right now too, is that they're kind of just good enough to not start rebuilding, but they don't go all in either. And I feel like the Ravens, like, what happens if the Ravens are 9-7 again and sneak into the playoffs, or 10-6 and are a wild card in the playoffs? And so they're good enough not really to get John Harbaugh fired, but not good enough to be a real Super Bowl contender.
Yeah, that's possible too. But you know, when you're John Harbaugh I've been hinting at this in some of my, you know, opinion pieces over the year. When you are John Harbaugh and you bring back your three coordinators and you say, we need to get better, you're really making that about personnel.
Yeah.
So now I wonder, and this is what I've been hinting at, I wonder what Eric DaCosta and Ozzie Newsome are thinking in that building right now, because he's basically saying, this is all about personnel because I'm bringing back my guys. Yeah. And they got to be thinking, well, I'm sure in some instances those guys are saying, I don't think they've coached these guys up the right way. I look at what they did at Kamala High Korea, who looked great in training camp, and suddenly they ask him to do all these other things that he's not accustomed to doing, and he starts playing slow. Yeah. And as soon as he starts to play slow and thinking too much, he takes out all of his instincts and all the things that made him good. And you know, he was really fast to the ball, and he was just a mess. So those guys, the personnel people, have to be saying, well, the coaches really haven't developed these guys right. You know, we've been hearing all season long about how Breshad Perryman can't run routes. Well, when's that going to change?
Yeah.
I mean, what does he do all week long? What does Bobby Engram do with him?
And it's true. Like, we always blame when that stuff happens, when Matt Elam and those other draft picks don't work out, we always look straight at Ozzie Newsome and DaCosta, and we look at the guys making those personnel decisions. But we often don't look at the coaches who put those players in a position to succeed or not to succeed.
Yeah, I've heard from more than one person that John Harbaugh's focus next year is going to be exclusively on coaching. And the insinuation made there is that he has become bigger than just his job. In other words, he probably has a little bit too much say in things, and they're going to knock him down a peg. You know, he was the self-appointed czar around the castle, but that's not going to be the case going forward. So you're going to let your personnel guys be your personnel guys. And, you know, because those guys, you know, John, you could probably imagine is more involved in the draft process than Brian Billick was. Brian Billick seemed uninterested until he wanted a quarterback.
Except for Kyle Bowler, yeah.
That cost. Yeah. So, and then there was Adam Terry. They wanted to have him because he wanted to protect Kyle Bowler, and they reached for him. And so those were probably the two biggest picks that Brian Billick was involved in. They were both busts.
But you do have
so
to.
But my point is that Harbaugh's a little bit more involved, and therefore, you know, the coaching staff and the scouts need to work hand in hand to see, well, what kind of team do we want to build? What kind of identity do we want to build?
Yeah.
And then work towards those kinds of players. But I think you see that who do you have to beat first? You got to beat your division rivals. And your division rivals, the Bengals, I'm not even going to count up the Browns yet. Yeah. we have those guys. I mean, they know those guys so well, but if you look at those two teams and the Ravens, they're built very similarly, but the difference is they have some big playmakers on their team, and the Ravens don't have those playmakers.
Yep.
Right.
And that's what they need to get. I've been saying that they need to be bold in free agency. I know they're up against it. They're going to have to get out their scalpel and do some carving with that to make that cap structure look better, so they can go out and get a splash free agency acquisition. But they need to find that guy. I would prefer that to be a wide receiver, because a wide receiver, we just have struggled for years and years and years to develop. So let's go out and buy one of those guys, and then let's get bold with our picks. You got 8 draft picks this year, including the Clutchy Assembly third round compensatory pick. So why don't they trade up sometimes? If you're going to draft at 16 and you see this edge rusher, this young edge rusher at number 7 who's on the board, be bold and do what it takes to move up and get that guy.
Yeah, I agree.
Because they're not that far away. They're an edge rusher, another corner, and a number 1 wide receiver away from contending for a Super Bowl.
Yeah, and what you're pointing out are those positions where the Ravens are really old, and that really hurt us late in the season as Dumervil and Suggs got worn out. The other issue we saw with John Harbaugh this year and just player management is Devin Hester. and given him try after try after try, to just when he clearly was not the guy from the first time he was back there.
Yeah, I think that's another situation where Jerry Rosberg seems to have a lot more say than he should for a special teams coordinator. And maybe that has to do with, you know, John Harbaugh having that kind of background himself. I'm told that of those coordinators, that Jerry Rosberg is the one he's actually a real good friend with. The other guys are just coworkers. But, you know, Rosberg, I think, has too much say in game day decisions. You know, whoever the inactives, you're always sitting there every week and scratching your head, why is this guy inactive?
Yeah.
And it's usually because the guy who's up in front of him, the guy that you're questioning, is a special teams player who can run down the field on kickoffs just to see the other guy on the other team take a knee and get it at the 25-yard line.
That's exactly right.
Hey, but when your MVP's coming out of special teams.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hey, Tony.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But to finish the question, the answer on Devin Hester, yeah. I think that Hester stayed around that long because Jerry Rosberg believed in him, and it turned out to blow up in his face.
Yeah, it was a disaster. But let's talk about Joe Flacco here for a second, all right? So most passing yards of his career this year, 4,317. Most completions of his career, 436. Highest completion percentage of his career, 64.9. Is it fair to say, Tony, that Joe Flacco had a breakout year this year?
No, not at all.
I just want to see your head explode, Tony.
Joe, if you look at, to me, the most important statistic of all those is what do you gain per pass? You know, what's the average yardage per pass? And I think that Joe was only better than maybe four guys. And we're talking about really guys like Jay Cutler and Ryan Fitzpatrick and garbage like that. So, Joe, I think Joe had a bad year, and there's a lot of reasons for it. And I think, you know, the frustrating thing with Joe for me is that you see that he can do it. You know that he can do it. You see he's done it in the playoffs. But during the regular season, for whatever reason, he has like this three- or four-game lull, which you wonder, particularly when he's on the road, you wonder what he's thinking about. And he needs to clean that up because I think my biggest issue with him is consistency. You know he's got the physical tools. I just think he needs to find the right coordinator to match up with him. I'm going to take these guys at face value because, let's face it, they have a lot to lose by sticking with this more than we do, and they're willing to do that. So I worry that if they're 1-3 at the quarter poll next year, remember all those empty seats we saw at M&T Bank Stadium this year?
Yeah.
Going to be a lot more of those.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. I mean, I feel like at this point with Joe, you're tied to him, and he's consistent. Like, you know, he's that consistently inconsistent. Like, you know, he's gonna throw for 20 to 25 touchdowns. He's gonna throw 10 to 15 interceptions. 7 of them are gonna be horrendous interceptions. But you kind of know what you're getting with Joe. So the key is to build an offense and a scheme around Joe that kind of helps him avoid the mistakes and kind of highlight what he's good at, which the Ravens haven't been great at doing.
No, and they haven't been great at doing that because they haven't had the money to do it.
Yeah.
You know, with the cap. And because he soaks up so much of the cap that, you know, the picture you just painted with those statistics, you know, we could take that, but you can take that only if he's not paid to be something more than that. And he's being paid to be a lot more than that. And that's therein is the problem, because you're forcing other people on the team to step up and be better than they are, than they're being paid. You know, the great thing about Joe during those first 5 years when they made the playoffs every single year and won a Super Bowl is that he was playing under a rookie contract that allowed Ozzie Newsome to fill in around him. When he stepped up and got that big deal, then all of a sudden the onus was on Joe. You know, he had to play better than he did during those first 5 years, and so far he hasn't.
Joe finished the season with 6.42 yards per attempt. 27th in the NFL. The only quarterback worse,
stuff like that.
Only quarterbacks worse was Blake Bortles, Carson Wentz, and Brock Osweiler. That's not great company.
I rest my case.
All you had to do is watch last week's game where every other pass was to Dennis Pitta for 4 yards. Like, okay. Like, that's your that's the offense right there. So you're right. We need an offensive playmaker. I'm with you, Tony.
Is that a lack of trust, or is it like the announcers were saying on Sunday, the Raven receivers never get open?
I don't think that's true. I think if you look at that coach's film on the NFL Game Pass, you'll see that the Ravens receivers get open plenty. Joe doesn't see them because I think there's a few things that he does that prevents him from seeing them. And one of them I'll blame on the injury because – you know, once you're injured, you're probably looking to protect that front foot and, you know, his left knee. And he probably didn't step in the throws the way he probably wanted to. And, you know, subconsciously, he didn't want that thing to get hit again. So I think that there's this subconscious clock ticking in his head that made him deliver the ball prematurely. That's why we're calling him Check Down Joe by the end of the year, because that's all he did, either to Kyle Juszczyk or to Dennis Pitta, just Check Down Joe. When Artie Morningweg designs a play, the play is designed to give a quarterback a few options, and sometimes those options are supposed to be in the same line of view. In other words, if he's looking out to his left and there's a short route on a slant coming across, sometimes they got a post corner running the same way beyond that cornerback so that he can, if one's covered, he can throw it to the deeper pattern. And a lot of times he failed to see that because pre-snap, he determined where he was going to go with the ball. Perfect example was against the Eagles that day when they had a 10-point lead down on the 11-yard line, I think it was, through that interception with, what, about 6 minutes to go in the game and changed the whole complexion of that game. To me, I mean, this is right after a timeout. Those guys had to be saying coming out of that break, look, we're going to take a kill shot here.
Yeah.
And they're probably all excited about that. But if the kill shot's not there, get rid of it, and we'll run it the next two downs, and we'll run some clock off and kick the three, and we'll be up by 13 with about 4 minutes to play. So that had to be a discussion going on there, and he threw it anyway because he predetermined where he wanted to go with the football, and come hell or high water, he locked in on a guy, and by his own admission, he didn't see the linebacker that everybody else in the country saw.
And that's a classic example of a mistake of a first or second-year quarterback. But you wouldn't expect that to come from a veteran like Joe. And that's what's frustrating is that he's been around the block a few times. He should know better than that.
He can tantalize you with his skills and his ball placement sometimes, particularly when he steps into his throws.
Yeah.
And a perfect example of that was the Miami game. He was just on fire.
Oh, on fire, yeah.
And then he comes out and does those kinds of things. And I'm sure that those coordinators aren't all stupid guys. And that's got to frustrate them too, because their livelihoods depend on Joe. So you can say that Joe's really an offensive coordinator killer.
Tony, we appreciate you coming and spending some time in Section 336. Is there? I don't know what you got working on there in Russell Street Report. Is there? Do you have a new article out yet this week?
I put one out today, Good, Bad, and the Ugly for the season. I started to do it on Monday for the game on Sunday, and I said, who's going to want to read that? I figured I'll just do it for the season. And then I started to work on it this morning, and then I was watching the John Harbaugh press conference, and I said, well, I've got to incorporate some of that. So my thoughts and opinions on that I haven't perhaps even shared completely here are all in that article that I just posted, the Good, Bad, and the Ugly for the Ravens season.
All right, Tony, thanks, man. You are a wealth of knowledge when it comes to the Ravens, man. We appreciate you coming on with us. Thanks, man.
I appreciate you guys having me. Thanks a lot. Have a good night.
You too.
You used to call me on my. You used to. Yeah.
Josh is taking some advice from the chat room.
The chat room's complaining about.
About your lame one call away?
Yeah, the song that's nice and slow so that I can cue up the callers.
Yeah.
They wanted this song. Yeah. Do you know this song?
Yeah. Yeah, this is the guy dancing in a box, right? In the music video?
I don't know.
Yeah.
Intern's dancing.
I saw it on, I just typed it into Google, and I was like, I hope this is clean.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time you just played some explicit lyrics on the show by accident.
That's true.
Trying to get us that explicit tag.
And by the way, you can follow Tony Lombardi at RSR Lombardi on Twitter. Great follow on Twitter. He knows his stuff in terms of the Ravens. And again, Russell Street Report. Is the best website for Raven stuff.
Yeah, I can't believe it took us, what, 196 episodes to get him on the show?
You said that. I can't believe we haven't had
I feel like we did.
No, yeah, I feel like we did, too.
I checked. I could not find any record of Tony ever being on the show.
Oh, yeah. We need to have him on a lot more often.
At least our football season when we don't know what we're talking about.
Absolutely.
Hey, but it's all right. We made it through another football season pretending we knew.
Woo! All right, what's next? Baseball, right?
I always thought he'd call me an idiot after I was talking about, was this a breakout year for Joe? I was just going to see his reaction. This guy's serious? What
show did I just call into?
Oh, man. All right. You want to get to some Orioles? You want to get to some up and down? Where you guys want to go?
We can go wherever you want. I mean, the Orioles have done nothing.
That's not true.
All right. What have they done?
Jesus Montero, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Huge signing.
I don't even know who this guy is.
Okay.
Who's Jesus Montero?
He's famous for a few reasons. He's got a lot of stuff going on.
Softball in Australia?
Right? No. No, he used to be like top prospect, big name. Mm-hmm. Most recently, he was suspended.
50 games.
50 games.
Second.
Second
violation.
He was mentioned the first time in that. What was that?
The Mitchell report. The show has ended. Goodbye.
Our show hasn't ended.
What was that?
that was Tony getting off of Skype.
Oh, but the Mitchell report. He was mentioning that, and then the second time. Also, like, this guy's great. Also, like,
we've had Mitchell report guys on.
Yeah.
What else is new?
Also, he got in trouble. I don't think we had this before. He was like, for some reason, he was in a minor league game. I think he was coaching first base or something for some reason, and a scout tried to give him a hard time.
Really?
And so he took an ice cream sandwich and chucked it at the scout.
That's amazing.
And so a lot of people you'll see on Twitter making ice cream.
Guess what? We're getting signed at Springs Rain.
Yeah.
He's also famous for that. He's also famous for showing up 40 pounds overweight.
Yeah.
To the Seattle Mariners.
Oh,
and when given the reason why, he said, I just like to eat
ice cream sandwiches.
Well, I mean, that's what the panda did up in Boston.
Yeah, same situation.
Yeah. Same situation.
But panda was better. And another thing that he's famous for, and the Yankees love this, is Pineda, the Yankees pitcher. He's with the Yankees because he was traded straight up. Jesus Montero was traded from the Yankees to Seattle for Pineda, who went to New York.
Sure.
And then went on to use pine tar, gobs of it, to help him pitch better. But anyway, so this guy's been – he was a top prospect. He's been around the block a few times. Started off as a catcher, now transitioned over to first base.
And that's your Orioles news for the week.
All right. So we just signed another first baseman. We got a lot of first basemen.
Yeah, this is – I don't know.
Does this guy make the team?
No.
We signed Pedro Alvarez, and then we got him.
He goes to Bowie, and you just hope he
– doesn't kill someone.
Doesn't throw ice cream sandwiches at anybody.
You hope
he catches fire and lives up to his – like, takes baseball seriously, loses weight, and gets in shape, and starts to actually play. But he's like one of these lottery tickets, right? This one-in-a-million shot you hope works out.
Mm-hmm.
And every now and then they do work out. So, all right, fine.
As the Orioles –
but he won't play for the first 50 games, so
right.
He's suspended.
And how does that work? He can't be in the – he's got to be on the, what, 25 man for 50 suspended?
No,
or is it just 50?
No, because he was signed to a minor league contract. I don't even think he's on the 40 man.
So how does that work with your 50-day suspension, 50-game suspension?
I think he's just under contract with us.
You just missed the first 50 of the season?
Yeah.
All right.
I presume of the
but he has to
season.
Have a contract with someone in order for that 50 to go or something. All right.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, I don't know.
They're just doing the guy a favor.
Did you want Roger Davis? As the Orioles look for an outfielder.
Oh, is he off the board?
He's off the board. Just signed to the Oakland Athletics.
Yeah, I didn't really want him.
So, I sent you guys an article the other day. Stan the Fan wrote an interesting article.
I have no time for that nonsense.
About Chris Davis.
Yeah, nonsense.
You don't think there's an option of moving him to right field?
Here's why it doesn't work. Just think about this for a second. Just
right.
3-3-6ers, like, sit back.
We got a lot of first basemen.
Close your eyes and think about this outfield. In left field, you have Hyun-Soo Kim,
right,
who is not fleet of foot. In center,
center field's the problem.
Aging and older Adam Jones. In right field, Chris Davis. I'm just saying, you better hope they hit the ball right at you. It's like Sandlot every time. Just hold up your glove and close your eyes type thing. Because our outfield will be slow.
Right.
And I think we need to improve on our outfield offense. I mean, our outfield defense. That's not really improving on the outfield defense. I want someone out there, and it takes away a gold glove first baseman. I want someone out there who can run.
Right. And now, here's what I want. I want someone out there who can run in center field and move Adam Jones to right field. There's no case of that, right?
No, I don't think Adam Jones.
Buck won't move Adam to right field.
Yeah, that may happen at some point. I don't see that happening next year, though. I think he can still play. But don't put two slow guys on either side of him. Like, help him out by putting speedy guys next to him.
Right, right. I mean, we're in January now. This is when Duquette actually answers the phone.
Yeah.
Makes some phone calls. He's going to have to find someone, or is he sitting back saying, I'll just put Rickert in right.
Yeah, he may. And that might be like I'm sure that's not plan A. Like, I'm sure
plan A's gotta
is
be
to upgrade.
An upgrade and a platoon. Well, I'm getting the feeling that plan A is Trumbo. And plan A is let's do it again.
Trumbo at DH and Angel Pagan to go along with that in right field. That's plan A.
I'd go with that.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure plan A with Duquette is Trumbo
in right
field.
I don't think
and,
so.
And Alvarez Mancini DH.
I hope not.
Our friend Trey Mancini was on MLB radio this morning.
Yeah.
And he mentioned that he has been practicing lately in the outfield.
Yeah.
So I'd like to think we prompted him to do that.
Yeah. I love the platoon idea of Mancini and Kim. That's the platoon I like.
Mancini, Kim?
Yeah. In left field.
Yeah, I don't mind that.
Lefty, righty.
As long as
Mancini against the lefties, Kim against the righties.
I like that in the lineup. As long as Mancini can play the outfield.
He can't be that much worse than Kim.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I have no clue. I know some people struggle going to the outfield.
But, like, I'm willing to sacrifice bad left field, average center field, but can we get above average at one outfield position, please?
Yeah, or just speed, because the other problem we have is leadoff position. We haven't had a leadoff hitter since Brian Roberts.
Yeah.
And I'm not counting Nick Markakis.
Yeah, but I'm not a big speed guy with...
Yeah, you want OBP.
I want OBP.
So who are you putting, Kim? As long as he's better than spring training.
Versus righties, yeah. I'll put Kim versus righties. And I'll go with someone else versus lefties.
Yeah.
I'll probably go with Manny Machado versus lefties.
You always want Manny Machado in leadoff. You've had that conversation.
It's softball
before.
Logic. The best hitter should get the most at bats.
Sure.
Yeah, I like that logic. Buck doesn't seem to buy that logic.
I know. What does Buck know? All right.
Not enough to win a playoff game.
Let's get to our three up, three down segment.
You surprised me on it.
It's now time
and the
for
intro.
Three up and three down.
I'm just itching to hear Bert's three up and three down.
Me too.
This is the segment where we share three things that are going well and three downers with the Orioles or with Baltimore Sports or
sure.
with our own lives.
Yeah, yeah.
So, boys, what's going well? Should I say, I always kind of spoil it at the beginning, but my up is Boy Meets World Season 5. The greatest season of any show in the history of all shows.
I'm speechless. There's great television out there, and Boy Meets World is...
Season 5 is better than
all
of it.
Put in that category. It's
absolutely,
good.
Absolutely.
Good for you. It's great. My up is that the Ravens season is over.
That sounds about right.
It was just a disaster of a season all season long. I complained about it on this show every week that I was here. And I'm ready to move on to bigger and better things, including this weekend, which I guess we'll touch on after this segment maybe.
All right. And I'm going to stick with Matt and go with television because thanks to some extra time at home, I watched the season 2 of Zoo.
Really, season 2 out?
It's on Netflix.
Season 2 of Zoo?
Season 1 of Zoo.
Season Zoo?
That's also when I finished it and found out that show's on CBS every Tuesday.
Yeah, yeah.
I had no clue it was on real TV.
I didn't know there was a
Was it about like zookeepers and stuff and the day-to-day tasks of taking care of a zoo?
The animals get smart.
The animals are taking over.
Ooh. Like they all decided to team
think
up
of like
and take out humans.
Right.
Can they talk?
No. It's interesting.
It's kind of like Planet of the Apes.
Okay.
But all animals.
Do they just like make eye contact with each other and they're like,
it's
let's
all,
go
it's all
kill
instinctual.
These humans?
It's all instincts. And, yeah.
Oh, instinctual. Yeah. I thought you said sexual.
No. I'm sure there's some of that going
and then,
on, too.
And Homeland's back, which is like my favorite show.
Yeah, I'm a few seasons behind on that one.
I skipped out of halfway through season 2 of that.
Oh, I haven't started season 1 yet.
Intern, you want to share something up with us?
What's up with you?
What's up?
I guess I'll also keep it in the TV realm. So since I was sick all last week, I was able to watch The Man in the High Castle season 2.
Oh, nice. Love season 1.
Oh, man. It is so good.
Season 2 does not disappoint?
No, it's better.
Oh, wow. I'm excited about that.
He can't compare. He didn't watch season 1, but...
No, I really enjoyed season 1. Really, that's another cool concept for a show, right? What if the Nazis won? Yeah. Very cool concept.
Yeah, no, it was interesting.
Interesting.
Yeah.
We got an up from the chat room saying that Jacob Rock's up is knowing that Justin Tucker is a lock for the 2016 Ravens MVP.
There you go.
See, I would call that a down. There is never a situation where your kicker should be your MVP. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's true.
You're a good guy, Jacob, but I got to disagree. Or no, I do agree.
Justin Tucker.
I agree that it is him. Yeah, you're right. I just would not call that an up.
I mean, you hang out with almost any other football team fan base, and whenever the kicker comes on and kick like a 45-yarder, they're like biting their teeth. They're stressed out.
Yes.
With us, 55-yarder, it's good.
Yeah.
It's
and if you need it and you're 60, just go for it because there's a pretty good chance he'll make it.
Right. And I remember at the Steelers game, we'd get upset at Harbaugh for not letting him kick ridiculously long.
The only way to stop Justin Tucker is some shady leapfrogging stuff. Other than that, he's unstoppable.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. All right, let's go to downs.
Yeah, let's.
My down is my Twitter game.
Really?
Yeah.
Is it down?
I'm just not very good at it. And I'm amazed because there are people out there who are really good at Twitter.
Oh, yeah.
It's really interesting, right? You would, if they try to do a podcast, they couldn't do it. They couldn't do what we do here. This amazing thing where we sit for an hour and 10 minutes every week and we discuss sports.
Wink at the camera.
They couldn't do it. Not everyone can do this. Some Baltimore people think they can do this and they start their own little podcast. There's like that Baltimore Opinionator or whatever. And it's like kind of falls down their face because they can't do it. So some people try.
Wait, did it end?
No, I don't know. It's probably still going on. I don't pay attention. But not everyone can do what we do. But other people on Twitter are just fantastic.
Yeah.
So I tried to...
like Donald Trump. Is that where you're going? You going with some Donald Trump?
No, I'm saying these people are...
He's really good at Twitter.
Donald Trump is the best at Twitter.
So someone it was tweeted out the news about...
Russia. I'm with you, Donald Trump.
No, I'm talking Orioles here, all right?
Guantanamo Bay.
Oh, man. So Madison Rock tweeted out that we signed Jesus Montero.
Yes.
Right.
And then I looked at the comments people wrote about the signing, and someone wrote, wow, that seals a championship, in like 10 exclamation marks.
Right.
Thomas Arnold, he tweeted that out. And so I responded. I thought he was being sarcastic.
That's what you're proud of?
So I was taking his sarcasm to a different level with my sarcastic response.
Sure.
So I said, whenever Orioles sign a minor leaguer, people tweet about a championship. Not sure how minor leaguers will help or seal a championship. ? Curious emoji. Now, obviously, I know that guy is being sarcastic, but I was being overly sarcastic by thinking he was serious.
Right.
So I think I'm proud of myself. I think I just owned him. Then he came back and he owned me.
Oh,
so,
really?
Yeah. So he came back with this. He said, I got some notifications. Let me scroll through because I get all these notifications. He said, he's not a minor leaguer. They signed him to a minor league contract. He's been the majors since 2011.
Oh, it's a Duquette steal.
We're talking about championship. I'm trying to call him out for being sarcastic. He does like a whole 180 and talks about how I'm wrong for calling him a minor leaguer when he's really a major leaguer because he played in the major leagues 5 years ago. And I have no response to that. So you know what I did?
Blocked him.
I liked it. Wait. I liked the comment because I have no response to that.
Wait, so your up is some random guy's Twitter comment?
No, my down is how I suck at Twitter.
Oh, you're down. All right.
Because he got me. He played me. I have no response to that.
Your game is off.
All right.
Yeah, and this is coming from, and I don't want to brag out here or anything, but I have over 700 followers. Can you guys even imagine? Like,
no.
My influence on Twitter is unbelievable. Over 700 followers. You knuckleheads out there. This guy is 18 followers, and he just owned me.
18?
18, he owned me. I'm a guy with over 700 followers.
I've got 800.
You can't touch me.
871, it says.
871?
Yeah.
I got 555.
Oh, see? I have no respect for you. I don't even tweet at people who have under 1,000.
But you tweet at me all the time.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I have 95.
That's hurting my Twitter cred. My Twitter cred? hurting my Twitter cred. So I don't know how people are so darn clever. You will meet the most boring people in your life, intern, on Twitter. They're freaking hilarious. You're like, what is this?
Well, yeah, they get to stare at their screen for 5 minutes to type everything appropriately.
No, I just I'm pursuing my doctorate in literacy now, educational literacy, and we talk about how people have different strengths. It's not just about reading and writing. Like, people have different literacy strengths, and some people on Twitter, their Twitter game's strong. I need someone like to take over my Twitter so they can be clever. I just can't be clever on Twitter.
Yeah,
I'm hilarious in person. I have a charming personality, but when it comes to Twitter, I can't tweet worth crap.
Yep, it's practice. You just don't do it often enough.
No, do you know how many times I tweeted?
12.
Well, is it going to tell me?
How many tweets you have?
I don't know.
Yeah, it tells you.
Is there a tweet number? I bet I've tweeted a lot.
I don't know how you look at that.
No.
We can check those stats later.
Yeah, it says I have 0 moments. What does that mean? It says my followers, how many people I'm following, my likes, and then moments.
You have tweeted 5,605 times.
And I can't tweet after 5,000 times. I can't.
5,600 some? What now, about me?
That's over the course of like 10 years. But
look me up, intern. Do your job.
Over the course of 10 years, but I still can't make a clever tweet.
Bert, you have tweeted 6,036
times. Wow, I'm more than you, buddy.
Oh, those are small numbers. I guarantee I'm bigger than that.
Oh, I'm sure you are.
Check Josh.
You were early in the Twitter game, too. That was before,
yeah, I was on
before
there,
me, before Matt came last,
that's
probably.
True.
I was on there before all the Oriole fans.
Josh
before
Soroka.
It became a place for sports.
Josh Soroka is at 16,900 tweets.
16,000.
16,000.
10,000 more than me.
You guys got some catching up
to
do.
But you're always teching at blog people or tweeting at blog, like
sometimes.
Tech people.
Yeah.
And
sometimes. I've been arguing with Drew Forrester a lot lately.
Ah.
About this, the Ravens decisions.
I'll go next with my down, just to reiterate, Cal Ripken Jr. at the Epcot Candlelight Processional last week. Did you see? I tweeted pictures of it. Did you see this? Of him wiping his.
Oh, it really is.
He was doing it so much.
In front of everyone.
Two pictures, and I tweeted both of them.
Oh, wow.
Josh, did you see those? I tweeted them.
Yeah, that's nice.
Poor Cal. But, hey, he's still my favorite Oriole of all time.
Well, he's the same with Twitter. Like,
even if he botched the candlelight.
Malcolm Gladwell talks about the 10,000-hour rule. How you do something for 10,000 hours to become an expert at it?
Mm-hmm.
He needs to read for 10,000 hours. I need to tweet for 10,000 hours before we can all become good at these things. The 10,000-hour rule.
Yeah, and I have been zany for way more than 10,000 hours.
Yeah.
That's how I have perfected this.
That's right. And I've been endearing and stuttering for certainly more than 10,000 hours.
Way more.
That's why I'm so freaking endearing, and I stutter so well. I'm a great stutterer.
My down is the fact that we have no football or baseball right now.
Is that a down or an up?
It's a down.
Because I'm a little bit Bert on this one. It's
yeah,
kind of an up.
That's kind of an up that it's ugly football's over. But the fact that now we got to go, 2 months before we get to start talking baseball again?
It's all right, because we got a couple other stuff, Gus, that's going on right now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That's right, boys and girls. You know what that music means. I sure don't, but hopefully you do. That's the music for
an announcement? Is that announcement music?
It was the Baltimore Blast February pump-up video.
Okay, nice.
Interesting.
Nice.
I thought they would say Baltimore Blast at some point. They
see,
don't.
For me, the Baltimore Blast theme song is Celebrate Good Times, Come On, because that's what they used to play every time the Blast would score a goal.
That's a good song. It makes me excited.
And then every time they score a goal, they announce the score up on the board as how many goals is that? And if it's like their fourth goal of the night, they count them out. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then they go, we want more, right? Josh, does this ring a bell at all?
Yeah, from like when I was like 6. That's the problem.
We were children.
We haven't been in 30 years. We've joked for like 4 years about going to a Blast.
Since we started this show.
Because they were the team that was always winning.
Turn up the heat with the Baltimore Blast. Blast soccer is hotter than ever, so get in on the action as the Blast continue their 10th MISL season. And Blast sellout their backs, so reserve your seats now. Call Blast Charge at 481-6000. Be part of the Blast experience. The fast-paced action of MISL soccer is burning up the turf at the Baltimore Arena. So turn up the heat if you can handle the Blast. Call Blast Charge, 481-6000.
That's got to be an old ad because they don't even tell you the 410 or 443.
Exactly. That's from 1992.
And they call it the Baltimore Arena.
It was very blurry, but at least it had some audio. But hey, it sounds like fun. We're going to get to go down to the Royal Farms Arena.
We're going to see some indoor soccer.
We're going.
Section 336 is going to the blast.
I mean, we've joked long enough that it's time we're actually going to do it. We're going Saturday.
And you can thank the Baltimore Ravens for crapping the season and not going to the playoffs, because otherwise we'd be watching Ravens playing a football game, playoff game, this Saturday.
Right. It almost,
instead, we're going to watch an indoor soccer.
Right. Yeah.
It's almost like we lost a bet.
Good work, guys.
But, people who like the blast say it's exciting. The commercials in the 90s said it was exciting.
Yeah. It's our third.
My wife also likes the Desperate Housewives shows, but it doesn't mean they're good.
Oh. The professional sports franchises in this town are Orioles, Ravens. What would be third?
The Blast.
It's got to be the Blast,
it's the Blast,
right? The Baltimore Blast. There is no other third Baltimore team.
It's the Blast.
Yeah, I mean, and Maryland basketball.
That's not a Baltimore thing.
I know it's not Baltimore.
It's the
but
Blast.
But we don't live in Baltimore. We live in Maryland.
We've made fun of the Blast for too many years. It's time to actually check it out for ourselves.
Well, we're going to give it a chance.
I'm willing to go in with the open heart and open mind.
That's right.
Intern was begging before show if he could go.
All right, speaking of intern, intern's about to share his down, though, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, my down has been how, like, just adequate the Maryland Terrapins have been this season.
Yeah. It's still lost early.
Lost to Nebraska by 2 points.
Yeah, lost a big lead in that game. I mean, this is going to be the Maryland season a little bit because we're starting three freshmen, a lot of freshmen, a lot of growing pains.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they're pretty fun to watch. They shoot the three a lot. Cohen is like a little Trimble, drives to the basket hard. Trimble's fun to watch always. But, yeah, I agree. It was a tough loss to Nebraska. After the big win against the Fighting Illini, and they had a big lead against Nebraska, you thought, tough loss to Nebraska.
That's a conference game too, right?
Yeah, they're all conference games now. This is where it heats up.
I saw them beat Illinois pretty good.
Yeah.
But Illinois stinks.
I guess so. I don't know.
I don't know.
It's early to tell.
I'll pay attention in
a
month and a half.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't get to the Big Ten conference championship.
Yeah. All right, boys and girls, we're about to wrap up this show. Let's kick it over to the intern for some thoughts, corrections, fun facts.
He hasn't
analysis.
Been here in so long, I forgot his music.
There
it is.
I've got music. So, unfortunately, there weren't, like, corrections or, like...
That's not unfortunate.
That's good.
Yeah. Why do you want us to fail? You want us to fail, intern. Why?
It's funnier for me.
Yeah, okay.
But I looked up some fun facts and some objects that are dropped on New Year's Eve other than the famous Times Square ball.
Ooh, I like this.
In Hagerstown, Maryland, they drop a giant donut in honor of a local donut shop that has been open since 1934.
All right. Cool.
Go Hagerstown.
And in Princess Anne, Maryland... Which is over on your shore.
Yeah,
Matt.
Nice.
Princess Anne?
Yeah. A stuffed muskrat in a top hat and a bow tie named Marshall P. Muskrat is dropped for New Year's Eve.
I am going there next year.
I like that.
I didn't know that. I'm going there next year.
Marshall
standing
P.
right
muskrat.
Here on the show. I'm going there next year and seeing that.
I'm Googling a picture of Marshall P.
And I'm doing
P.
Facebook
muskrat.
Live. I'm going to video the whole thing. That's great.
And that's all.
Bye.
Nice. And over here in Arnold, Josh drops his dinner. So all those things are
dropped. But why? Why
McDowell?
All right.
I like this Marshall P. Muskrat. It is literally a stuffed muskrat. Like, it's dead. It's been taxidermied or whatever.
Yeah, I wonder.
And he's wearing a top hat.
What's the history of that? I'm sure there's a cool backstory. Now, that's a cool story time. However, that started to be a thing. That's a story time.
Well, you want to start a new podcast, Weird Stories
yeah.
from the Eastern Shore? I'm sure you can get plenty of them.
The way the Orioles aren't making any moves and the Ravens are out.
I know.
You got to come up with stuff.
I know. We're going to
fill the airtime.
We're going to talk about the Blast next week. Who knows what after that?
Yeah, absolutely. Who knows? Who knows after that? Oh, man. You know what? Is there anything on the chat room? I completely ignored the chat room this episode. I didn't even have it open. I'm sorry.
I took care of the chat room with their little hotline.
Oh, that's true.
Took care of them. I'll figure out what that song is later, but I played it for him.
According to this, the Maryland Department of Natural Resources donated the preserved rodent to town leaders who decided that no better way to showcase a regional trapping delicacy than to present it at the start of the new year.
And this is Marshall P. Muskrat.
Yes, the one and only Marshall P. Muskrat.
All right, so a couple of recent chats from the chat room. Michael Newman says 10,000 tweets, but you have to spend an hour on each one. Then you become a pro, thus accomplishing a 10,000-hour rule.
Makes sense.
And getting 10,000 tweets out there. That's true. And when I construct my tweets, I do spend about an hour on each tweet. And son of a gun if there's not a typo in every single tweet I send out.
Mine too.
Even after preparing for an hour.
Right.
I'll double read it and then still typo.
That's why I've got so many tweets, because of fixing corrections.
Yeah.
Is that your way of inserting the stuttering into your tweets, though, is that you have a typo or something?
Maybe. Yeah, that's my endearing typo.
Yeah, exactly.
I like that. Jacob Rock, he tweeted at blast time. And you're right. On Saturday, it's going to be blast time. And we're going to have a blast watching the blast.
Absolutely.
As they turn up the fire, because it's going to get hot.
We're going to have a lot to talk about next Tuesday.
You Absolutely. Think they have, like, indoor fireworks or something when they score?
Pyrotechnics?
They something weird. Some yeah. pyrotechnics, some fire.
Or maybe we just bring our own indoor fireworks. I don't know. Let's get crazy here.
Sure.
Yeah. All right, boys and girls. Thanks for joining us for another awesome episode. Another shout-out to Tony Lombardi for joining us here on the show. Have to come back here on at some point. Appreciate the intern for all those fun facts. You can follow us on Twitter, Section 336 Show. You can follow us on Facebook or like us on Facebook. You can like us in person at the Blast game on Saturday.
Let's do it.
You can follow me on Twitter at Section 336. You can follow the zany one, Darth Vader himself.
At Burt Rohde.
Hey, it's a soccer game, so aren't you supposed to bring, like, flags to wave around at soccer games and stuff? That's what I see on TV.
You better bring
that. Yeah, vuvuzelas, exactly.
And bring that lightsaber, because I heard fights break all the time, and things get ugly.
Yeah.
Red is the blast color.
Perfect.
Yeah, we need some tips on what to take to the blast game.
Yeah.
Tweet at us.
Or, like, simple, can I take food in?
I can't get this thing off.
I don't want to make a fool of myself.
Hey, does the Royal Farms Arena sell Royal Farms?
That's a great question.
Ask Justin Tucker.
I'd be way more into the blast if all their concession stands are Royal Farms.
I have an app, a Royal Farms app. Let me get the free coffee. Can I use that at the stadium? At the arena? I'm sorry.
I don't know. I got thousands of questions.
Yeah.
Hit us up.
We got to look into this. You can also follow Josh on Twitter.
At Josh Soroka.
And you can follow the intern.
At WW Intern.
But I wouldn't recommend it. Thanks for listening, boys and girls. And as always, go blast.
Section 3. Report.